Hey, how are you? Hi, Jollifs. Hello over there. Oh, there's two of you there. Oh, there's two there too. Oh, here come a couple. Happy birthday. Happy birthday! Today or yesterday? I'm Instagram friends with all of your friends and all that comes up, happy birthday, and I'm like, oh God, him again, here he goes, click, 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 click. And of course, it's the same with all the girls that from school, from Calabria Ridge. Hello, good to see you. They're all still coming. Hey guys, come on in. No point standing here on my own. Hello, Will, Will's friend. Hello. Hello, Ella, Dan. Hi, Suella, hello. Hello! I don't know who that is. Oh, that's my friend Nicole and her daughter Ash. She gets a special welcome. Hey. Hi, guys. Don't sit down. We need to sing. I'll pray when everyone else comes in. All right, should we get them all standing up? Can they sing? Can they stand? We can. All right, everybody stand up. Let's sing.
Let's sing. We'll be right back. take a seat and pray with me.
Heavenly Father, we praise you for the wonderful gifts that you give us, for the music to worship to, for the freedom to praise you, and for friendships to share in your name. Open our hearts and open our minds to you tonight, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Welcome to church. It's good to see you here. For those that don't know, I'm really sorry. My name's Natalie. Get to know me. No, I need a pity laugh. Thank you. Good job. All right. So, we are starting a new sermon series, and it is called Gospel-Shaped Outreach. And I asked Josh what the name of his sermon was, and he said, The Introduction to Gospel-Shaped Outreach. So he's starting up this. He's been the first person to do it tonight. All right. Time for announcements. You ready? I'm sorry, what? Thank you. Thank you, thank you. All right. What do we have after the service tonight?
Pizza.
Pizza. BYO. No, make your own pizza. Okay, bring $5. Hopefully you've bought some really weird things to put on your pizza, like anchovies, broccoli, that sort of stuff. Okay, so that's straight after the service. Head on outside after the service, not now, after the service. Okay, so pizza. Men, you are going to meet the challenge, men. Josh, when are men going to meet the challenge? 26th of March? Okay. All right, talk to Josh, for those in here, the men. If you're a female, sorry, we get our own later on. But men, you get to meet the challenge on the 26th. Have a chat to Josh, he knows what's going on. Hey, this sounds exciting. The AGM's next week. So much fun, I can't wait. Okay, so if you're keen and interested to know what goes on in this church and the monetary and all those sorts of bits and pieces, please come along to the AGM. I'm sure they would love to have you, and they'd love to have some 6 p.m. representatives. Josh needs someone to talk to. Yep. All right, church picnic on Good Friday. Oh, now these are always good. Please tell me there's something behind me that says church picnic. Yes! Okay, Rouse Hill Regional Park. There you go. Come on Friday. Now, we only have one service on Good Friday, don't we? Yes, sure. I'm making this up as I go. In the past, we've had one. So don't come to church on Friday night, but come to church on Friday morning and then come to the picnic and go to Seafood Wizard and get some fish and chips and some salad and come on down and meet us down at Fabrosi. Oh, I got it right on Good Friday. All right, Josh has some important things to talk about. He's going to reconnect.
Whoop. Ooh, hello. Hello. Yeah, I just want to talk you guys through some stuff. It's been a rough couple of years, right, for everyone in a thousand different ways. Church, one of those ways in particular, though I recognise like heaps of other bits of life have been like that as well. And so over the first few months of this year, the leadership team, especially here at Quakers Campus, have been thinking and praying and wrestling with what does 2022 look like for us, right? What is 22 all about? For us. And a word that kept kind of coming up from multiple different people at multiple different times was that we really need 2022 to be about reconnecting, right? That there's so many different ways where we've been kind of fractured and we've disconnected in a host of different ways. And so we want 2022 to be about reconnecting. And so that's just something I wanted to share with you guys tonight and tell you some of the ways that we see that happening, and we're praying for that to happen this year so you can get excited about some of them. For those who don't know, our purposes here at LifeAC are still exactly what they've always been, right? We kind of think this captures what we're on about here at Life Anglican. And this is united. This is not just Quakers. This is at Rivo as well and at Marsden as well. That what we want to see, we want to be connecting people to Jesus. We want to be cultivating our faith in Jesus. And we want to be celebrating life with Jesus, right? That was the case before COVID hit. That's going to be the case after COVID hits, right? That's our DNA. Those are the things that we want to be doing and seeing here at LifeAC. But we kind of wanted to zoom in a little bit and say, not just in that broad, always kind of purpose, but in a specific kind of targeted way, what do we prayerfully think God wants to be doing in amongst us here at Quakers this year? And here's what we landed on as our vision for 2022, that we want to reconnect. That's not just a simple kind of just simplistic understanding of what we mean by reconnect, but actually quite a deep and holistic understanding of what we mean to reconnect. That we want to be reconnecting to God, that we want to be reconnecting to His people, and we want to be reconnecting to our community. And we're going to be doing hosts of things over the course of this year to kind of unpack this and to try and achieve under God these different goals. Let me talk you through just quickly each of them so that you can be thinking about them and praying for them and understanding why we're doing some of the things we're doing. One of the big things coming out of COVID for a lot of us has actually been that all of the things that have been happening, the disruptions to our rhythms, the extra kind of stresses and tensions that have come into our life, the sorrows, just the shakenness that we've experienced over these last few years have really hurt our relationships with God. Not for everyone. For some, they've actually grown closer to God through it. But for many of us, it's been harder. And so one of the things we really want to focus on now as we come back, having not been able to gather all that much and be encouraged by each other, having had our rhythms broken and spiritual disciplines suffer and our prayer life suffer and all of those things struggling, this year we want to say we want to focus on getting reconnected to God, right? Some of the places that we're really going to lean into for that purpose as this year goes on is like our life groups, which just started this last week, right? Our midweek groups where we get together, finally in other people's homes again, right? In one another's homes, to really focus on our relationship with God, right? And there's devotions is up there as well, things about spiritual disciplines that over the course of this year we want to roll out so that all of us finish 2022 more connected with God than we started 22, right? Isn't that our goal every year? But we're especially feeling that, and that's been kind of laid on our hearts for this year, to all be reconnecting with God. The next step of it then is not just to be reconnected with God, but at home isolated, which has been some of the pain of these last few years, but to actually reconnect to His people, right? To re-enter into those rhythms of committed church attendance and being with each other. But one of the big changes that's happened over these last 2 years, we've kind of accidentally learned how to consume church because so much of it's been on YouTube, right? And it's been disconnected from the people. And so actually what it looks like, not just to visually watch church every week, but to connect with God's people, to live alongside God's people, to serve alongside one another here at church. What it means to commit on a deeper level, right? We want to be encouraging and making opportunities for you guys all to commit to our gatherings together in deeper ways than maybe has been the case over these last few years, right? What's it look like for us to reconnect in our meetings with one another and by serving alongside each other? First step on that one, stick around for pizzas tonight. Next thing we want to be doing though, that started off looking at just us, now looking at our church, now let's zoom out a little bit. We've always wanted this, but we especially want this year, to connect our community to Jesus. It's been a rough couple of years in trying to connect to our community and connect them to Jesus, right? It's been hard to do that for a whole bunch of practical reasons. So this year, we want to kind of make up for lost time, right? Get out there and tell people the good news about Jesus. That's why we're doing the sermon series that I'm going to start off later tonight. This isn't it, sorry. But that's why we're doing the sermon series on gospel-shaped outreach. We're also going to be running, it's called Alpha Course. It's like this short series of getting together, and I don't want to call them classes, but like you get together, you have a meal or hang out and watch some videos and do some discussions in a small group to just start understanding what is it that Christians believe, right? And do I believe that? Who is this Jesus guy? What change would that lead to in my life? Do I want to start following Him, right? Super, super excellent kind of resource that's been put together to help someone who's a little bit interested in Christianity decide if they want to be a Christian. We're going to be running that as Life United starting in May through to June, and then we're going to repeat it multiple times during the rest of the year, right? So that if you're here tonight and you're like, maybe I should do that. I want to learn about Jesus and decide if I want to be a Christian. Stay tuned. That's coming up. Though we could even start something a bit earlier if that's you. Come and talk to me. But also, we can all be thinking and praying for our friends who we might want to invite along to those Alpha courses to help people hear about Jesus. And the other quadrant that we got there that fills the circle around is we want to reconnect to our community. Everything's become so broken over these last couple of years. We want to connect again with our community. Some of the big ways that we've always done that but haven't been able to lately, scripture in schools has taken a massive hit with all of the COVID restrictions, and a lot of scripture teachers, circumstances have changed in their life so they can't teach anymore. But it's a great opportunity to get into spaces where there's heaps of kids and families from the community who want to hear about Jesus, and we just need people who can say, I got a spare hour on a Tuesday afternoon, I got a spare 4 hours on a Wednesday, whatever it is that you've got, that you might be able to do some training, get the resources, we'll train you up, we'll give you the curriculum to go and teach some scripture classes. That would be a wonderful way to do that, for example. Another example, Quack is back on this year. Right? Quack went really well, all things considered, last year, but it was all things considered, right? Because we were in isolation trying to run a kids club for 400 kids. This year, we're back. We're planning on being back here on site, all the kids, and we need the leadership team back, and we want to be connecting with families, connecting with parents, connecting out into the community. That's going to be a big focus of our year. So that's our four things. What are we going to be on about at Quakers Hill this year, 2022? Reconnecting, right? Reconnecting to God, reconnecting to His people, connecting the community to Jesus, and reconnecting more broadly with our community. And pretty much as the staff team, ministry team here at Quakers, we're excited about it, right? We've been talking about this for months now, sending emails back and forwards. We're expecting good things from it because this is something that's come up from multiple places that just seems like God is laying it on different people's heart at the same time, and it's really what He wants us to be on. So we're expecting God to do things through this, and we are praying heaps about it. And so I want to invite you guys to be excited, to be expectant, and to be praying about it as well. I'm going to pray about it right now, and then once we're into that rhythm of praying, let's keep praying. I'm going to invite Ella up to keep leading us as a congregation. But for now, let's pray about some of this stuff. Our Lord God, You know what the individuals in this church have been through over the last few years, and the disconnections that have happened between You and between us as community and between us and our community. You know the places that has happened, not just with individuals, but with us as a church. And God, we ask that this year might be a year of reconnection and healing and growth and flourishing for our congregation and for our campus here at Quakers. Please encourage us, inspire us, incline us to be a part of this vision, to be a part of what it is that You're doing here at Quakers this year. And we pray that at the end of this year, we might look back and we might reflect on a year where we have been more deeply connected to You. We have become more deeply connected to one another. And people who do not yet know You or us might have come to know us, and more importantly, might have come to know You and Your love and Your grace this year. We ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks, Ella.
Let's continue praying. Lord God, we humble ourselves here. And we wait expectantly, not on You to say yes to our prayers, but we pray that through the power of prayer, we will be able to align our hearts with Yours. God, there is so much happening in our church, in the world. Thank You that You are sovereign and that You reign over all. Lord, I pray for this Life United revision and reconnect. Lord, I pray that Your work in the church, in amongst our relationships, so that we may be able to grow in community, so we may be able to grow in our own faith and growing the church as well. Lord, I pray that You'll give us bold faith this year, where we will reach out to those who haven't come to church in a while, that You'll draw those people back. Lord, I pray that we will have bold faith in our workplaces, in our school lives and uni lives, that people will know that there is something different about Your church, about Your body, because we point back to Jesus. Lord, I pray that You'll work in all of us this week, that we'll be able to point to You in everything we do, in every conversation that we have, and in every thought that we think. Lord, I pray for the wider world that is just going through so much suffering at the moment. We recognize the complexity, and we don't recognize the complexity as well of the situation in the Ukraine and with Russia. Lord, I pray that Your sovereignty will reign over this, that Your will be done, and that ultimately You will be glorified. that you will comfort those who are grieving and who are lost, and for those people that feel lost, that they will be able to see your light and look to you. Lord, I also pray for our brothers and sisters in Queensland and up in New South Wales who are suffering the impacts of the rain and the floods this week. Lord, I pray for those who have had houses damaged, their workplaces destroyed, and their livelihoods replaced. Lord, I pray that you'll comfort them. Thank you for the great Australian community that has already provided aid, and Lord, I pray that you'll stir our hearts to be inclined to pray, to give, and to love these people in our community. Yeah, Lord, we just pray that your hand will be over the devastation that the world is at the moment, and that you'll grant peace. Thank you that we can have ultimate peace through you, and that we look forward to that day when there will be no conflict and no war and no brokenness and no natural disasters, and there will just be perfect relationship with each other and the world and with you. And Lord, keep our eyes focused on that day as we see it approaching. Keep our eyes fixed on you and our hearts inclined towards you and not ourselves this week. Amen.
Let's continue worshipping together. Please stand.
Pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our
Evening, everyone. Take a seat. Tonight's passage is from a book that I've actually really learned to love over the last month, because I've been teaching from it from Scripture. So that's a Scripture plug for you guys. So we're going to the book of Acts. We're just looking at chapter 1, so it's just after the four Gospels. Thank you, Josh. All right, starting from chapter 1. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized you with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." So when they met together, they asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven."
Thanks, Bella. I was going to say good evening, but I've already been up here once, right? But good evening. If we haven't met, my name's Josh. I'm the pastor who looks after the 6 p.m. service. Love it. And especially the part that I love the most is getting to talk to you guys about what the Bible says, right? About what God has to say to us. So pumped to get to do that again tonight. Before we get started about gospel-shaped outreach, I've got some numbers I want you guys to remember for about 15 minutes' time, right? We'll see how we go. Whoop, see if this will... There we go. First one, I'm going to tell you what it is. The number is 200,000. 200,000 is the, I think, fairly staggeringly large number of unsolved homicides in the United States, right? That would be an absurdly large number for Australia, right? But in the United States, 200,000 murders over about the last 3 to 4 decades have remained unsolved. The numbers I want you to remember are 91, 63, 3, and 63, right? And you never know, the order that the tables go out to make their pizzas or something like that might hinge on who remembers those numbers, so I hope you were quick. Did anyone get them? Anyone? We'll see. If you got them, hold on to them for 15 minutes. Our topic, though, like Nat introduced earlier, is gospel-shaped outreach. Now, for those of you who've been here with us over the last couple of years, the conviction that we've had and still have as a church is that every aspect of who we are should be gospel-shaped. What we mean by that, the gospel is the good news of who Jesus is, of Jesus' love for us, of the life that he lived for us, the things that he taught, the death that he died so that we could be forgiven and brought back into relationship with God. But not just the death he died, right? The fact that he came back from the dead, right? Conquered death, and now the hope that he gives us for eternity, right? That if we grab all of that, the way God has chosen to love us and offer grace and forgiveness to us, if we take that, that should shape everything about who we are. And if we rewind 2 years ago, we did a series in our life groups that meet during the week. We did a series called Gospel-Shaped Living. And we were just thinking about all the different impacts that the gospel has on how we live. Then last year, again in life groups, we did a series. Does anyone remember what it was? Gospel-Shaped Worship, right? Gospel-Shaped Worship. That is, firstly, in our lives, how do we just worship God by the way we live? How do we show him that he is wonderful and glorious by the way we live? And especially as we gather together as his people for our worship service, how is that shaped by the gospel? Not what someone else is doing in some concert or what the latest pop research says, but by the gospel. How can we be shaped by that? And so what we're doing now, this one we won't do in our life groups, where we're kind of grabbing our sermon series to cover this one. We're looking at gospel-shaped outreach, right? What do we mean when we say outreach? Another kind of word that might come up along the way, if you hear it, let me tell you what it means, would be evangelism. That would be a word that means similarly. It's kind of like saying outreach in ancient Greek in some ways, right? Here's what we mean by outreach. We believe that the gospel, that stuff I said before, Jesus' love for us, the life that he lived, the teaching that he gave, the death he died for our sake, him rising to new life, the hope he gives us for eternity, all of that, we believe that that is something that is wonderful, but not just wonderful for us to kind of hold on to and kind of my precious it and keep it to ourselves, right? But that actually it is wonderful for us to hold out, to reach out and offer that to people who don't yet know that love, right? Or don't yet know that hope, don't yet know that forgiveness, don't yet know that grace. That is not something for us to hoard to ourselves, but something for us to reach out and offer to others. That's what we mean when we say outreach. And here at LifeAC, we want to work really hard to make sure that our outreach, our sharing the gospel with those who don't yet know it so that others might be saved, that is gospel-shaped, right? That it's not like commercial, corporate, enterprise, business-based, that it's not like strategy-based, that it's none of those, but that it's shaped by the gospel. That's what we want to be focusing on. And to kick it off tonight, we're going to be doing that by looking at something that Jesus said about reaching out with the gospel. Right? We thought that's a pretty good place. Let's look at Jesus' own words when he told his followers to do outreach and see what he said it was and how to do it. So we're doing that from Acts chapter 1, that passage that Suella read out. If you've got a Bible with you, flick back open to Acts chapter 1. If you've got a phone, feel free to get it out. If you don't have either of those, that's fine. I'll put the verses up on the screen as well. Here we go. This is Acts chapter 1. Before we even start reading this, set some context because we don't want to take this for granted. Jesus has died. He's come back from the dead, and he's now been around for a couple of weeks making all kinds of convincing proofs in a capital city, the capital city where he was publicly killed. He's now made a bunch of convincing proofs that he's back from the dead. Let's not take that for granted, right? This is pretty special, what's been going on here. And then here's what happens on one of the many occasions that he was appearing after he came back from the dead. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you've heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. He said to them, it's not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, to the ends of the earth. Out of this passage, we're going to grab three truths. The first one I've put there in bold for you, and that's that Jesus said to his followers, when they're about to start doing outreach, they're about to share this great news about Jesus with the world, the first thing Jesus said was, wait. Wait. Right? In particular, wait for the Holy Spirit. Now, why did he need to tell them, wait for the Holy Spirit? If we were to go back, John chapter 16, right, Jesus is talking about the Holy Spirit, and he's told these guys, these followers, he's told them that as long as he, Jesus, is there, the Holy Spirit's not going to turn up. But when he goes, he'll send the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will give them all the power that they need for God's mission. Right? The Holy Spirit will comfort them, will help them, will transform their hearts from the inside out, will give them all kinds of gifts and abilities, that the Holy Spirit will be there for them to strengthen them for the task that Jesus has given them. He told them, that will happen, but not till I leave. And now he's talking to them, and he's there in person. And what he says to them is, wait until the Holy Spirit turns up. Wait until I give you the power for the mission. Here's why I think that's important. Here's what we need to hear from it. He says, wait for the Holy Spirit, because gospel-shaped outreach relies on God's power, not ours. Right? Because he could have said to them, wait, guys, you need to go and do a bit more practice back in a room somewhere with your public speaking and start a little bit of a workshop group where you give each other tips, right? And then you'll be good. He could have said, wait, guys, it'd be really good for you to kind of figure out a nice systematic, with some diagrams, way of explaining to people why I died on the cross. Right? He could have said, wait for that. He could have said, wait until you spend a little bit more time talking to someone and unpacking your own kind of personality traits and working on your assertiveness so that you can be bolder when you talk to people. He could have started listing a bunch of their own skills and competencies that they needed to work on. But he didn't. What was the thing he said they had to wait for? God's power. Because outreach doesn't happen as a function of our own power. It happens when God chooses to work through us, and they have to wait. But how do we apply that to us, right? Do we read that and say, well, therefore, what's the first step of outreach? Wait. Well, what was that moment in history that they were in? They were in a moment in history where Jesus said, as long as I'm here, no spirit, but once I go, spirit, right? That's the moment they were in, and so they had to wait. But what about us? We're past that, right? If we were to read Acts chapter 2, the Spirit turns up to all of the believers on the day of Pentecost. And then through the book of Acts, we kind of get this transition period of God's people receiving the Spirit until once we move through the book of Acts into kind of Paul's letters, the second half of the New Testament, we find that what Paul has landed on, what's kind of stabilized as the norm for God's people, is that anyone who trusts Jesus, anyone who is a Christian, receives the Holy Spirit. That there is no such thing as a Christian who doesn't have the Spirit or someone who has the Spirit but isn't a Christian. The two are synonymous. Right? If you want to kind of follow that up and that you want a little bit more on that, write down Romans chapter 8, verse 9. Because Paul, when he's writing to the Roman church, directly swaps it back and forwards. He says, anyone who is in Christ has the Spirit and anyone who doesn't have the Spirit is not in Christ. Right? So, where's this going to land for us? They didn't yet have the Spirit, and so they were told to wait. What would the instruction to us be? If we have already received the Spirit, don't wait. Right? Any other procrastinators here? Anyone else, if you were to think, what is my outreach, my sharing of the gospel with others characterized by? Waiting, right? Waiting till we both happen to be mowing the lawn at the same time and they invite me over or they start asking me about stuff and then I'll try and like maybe drop a hint as to why I go out on Sunday nights and maybe they'll ask me more and like waiting for the perfect opportunity to drop in my lap, right? Or maybe waiting until I've done a course that helps me know how to do it. Maybe waiting until I know more of the answers, I've got more of the knowledge to know how to argue against the points that they're going to have and stand up for the faith better, right? Waiting, waiting, waiting. What should we be doing instead? Trusting. Because outreach doesn't happen in our power. It happens by God's power. So we don't need to wait for our powers to grow. And we don't need to wait for His power to turn up because He's already given us the Spirit. If you're someone who, when it comes to outreach, is a procrastinator, a waiter, take that waiting, turn it into trusting, and just do it. What is that thing that you've been waiting? Is it to talk to someone in your family and you're just waiting for that perfect moment that may or may not ever come and really you know it's going to be up to God whether it works or not anyway? Stop waiting. Do it. Is it someone at work? Someone at school? Is it to volunteer to teach a scripture class? Is it to join a ministry here at church? Is it to invite the neighbors over for a barbecue? What is it for you when you think, if I were to throw myself into outreach, this is what I'd do, but at the moment I'm just waiting. What would it look like to stop waiting and start doing? You guys can think about that for yourselves, but part of the question that flows from that, I guess, is if we're going to just do it, we need to figure out what it is, right? What is it that they had to wait, but we don't have to? We can just get on with. Let's check out down at verse 8, down near the bottom. Jesus said, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth, right? What is it that outreach actually involves? How do we do outreach? How do we do evangelism? We put it up. We'd be witnesses, right? Now, fortunately, this isn't a particularly tricky ancient word that we have to try and figure out, is it? We still use this word now. Like, to be a witness is still a really obvious thing that we can understand and comprehend. What does a witness do? Sees something, hears something, knows something, and does what? Tells people. Tells people the things that they have seen or heard or know. right? That's what a witness does. And so as we think, what does it mean to do outreach? Please don't think that when I say just do it, what I mean is you have to memorize a spiel of everything about Jesus that you could just deliver to someone who hasn't even asked you to in the hope that they respond, right? That's not what we mean by outreach. What we mean by outreach is just be a witness to the things you've seen, heard, the things you know, right? Some of that will mean some of the things that you know are those things I was talking about Jesus, right? About his life, about his death, about his resurrection. And you're going to share about those. But even more personal are the ways that those truths about Jesus have been real for you, right? What are the ways in which walking with Jesus, if you've been walking with Jesus, what are the ways that you've experienced peace from God which you just can't humanly explain? Or a hope which has got you through harder times than you ever could have got through on your own? What are the ways that you've experienced that shame and guilt being washed away in a way that's just a burden falling from your shoulders? What are the ways that the gospel has impacted you? And if that's happened, just telling that story, being a witness, is outreach. It can be as simple as talking to people this morning over morning tea. It can be as simple as we read a little truth in the Bible at some point, and at some point we now bear witness to what we read about. Like we literally just say, oh, I read something in the Bible about that. Right? And it can be the smallest things. But to take those ways in which God is working in your life, the times he's answered your prayers, the times he's taught you things, the time he's given you hope and joy and peace and you've experienced that love from him, to take all of those things and testify about them, to just say them publicly in all kinds of different spaces. That's what witnessing is. Yeah, it's got that. Because let's get back to these numbers. 200,000 unsolved homicides in the United States. Can anyone tell me the numbers? Anyone know one? Angus. Oh. Nailed it. Angus's table can be the first ones to make pizza. Rochelle's in charge of that, but I'll help you out, Angus. Nailed it. Those are the numbers. Let me tell you what those numbers mean. The 91%. If we were to go back to the 1960s and 70s in the United States, 91% is the number of homicides on average that were solved, right? If we were to go back 40 years or so. 63% is the number of homicides in the United States that were being solved. I think the research I was reading was done in about 2014. So in the 2010s, right? It's dropped to 63%. Law enforcement's trying to figure out why. And the main hypothesis at the moment is the increase in gang violence that's going on, especially in some key population centers, some key cities within America. Because when there's gangs involved in the homicides that happen, witnesses don't speak. And that more and more, the intimidation of witnesses and the fear of witnesses who themselves are often involved in gangs as well, their willingness to speak disappears and these crimes go unsolved. There's people in America, law enforcement, police, all kinds of people, desperately looking to try and find the truth, right? Desperately investigating, experimenting, meeting new people, talking to new people, doing everything they can to try and find the truth. But they can't find it. And I wonder, metaphorically, whether something even more serious is happening in our society, right? In America, but even here in Quakers Hill, Acacia, Stanhope, Scully's, wherever you guys are from, right? That there are people around us who are investigating and searching for truth. And I don't want to say this glibly, they're investigating and searching for a truth that is even more important, even more critical than solving a homicide. They're searching for truth about their entire existence, about their life, what the point of it is, where they can find purpose, where they can find meaning, where they can find hope in this broken world and the broken world that they are living in and walking through, where they can find relief from that guilt and shame and the burdens that they carry, where they can find peace and joy. They're investigating and they're looking everywhere. And I wonder whether our society at the moment has the same problem that law enforcement in the States has. That there's a lot of witnesses who are scared, and we don't speak. And God's doing stuff in our life. He's answering prayers. He's teaching us stuff from His Word. He's transforming our hearts by His Spirit. And we're not telling people that those things are happening. Let me tell you the other numbers. I haven't told you all of them, have I? This whole 200,000 unsolved homicides kind of meant there was a new push, kind of a resurgence in, well, ever since the 90s and through into the 21st century, of task forces that are specifically tasked with trying to crack cold cases, right? Cases that have been closed for at least a year and often a lot more than a year, right? And so there's been a kind of a newfound interest in trying to reopen some of these unsolved homicides. And one of the big reasons that there was a push for that was developments in technology. They said, look, we got all these cases, but these cases came in before we really had proper DNA sequencing and we couldn't do quite as much testing. And surely now with our new forensics technologies, we'll be able to reopen those cases, re-examine them, and finally get some convictions on some of these cold cases. That's kind of part of the rationale for why they started it up. 3% is the number out of all of the cold cases that have subsequently been solved over that time. 3% of those were solved by DNA or other similar forensic tech advances, at 3%. How do you reckon 93% of them were solved? Of those that have been solved, 93% of them were solved because someone who was too scared to speak up before chose to speak up now. That somebody who hadn't been willing because they were afraid of the repercussions it was going to have in their life, circumstances have changed or that person has changed, and now they've spoken up, and the people who are searching for truth have found it. How is it that the people of Quakers Hill, Acacia Gardens, Concord, how is it that the people whose lives we walk alongside, how is it that they'll find their truth, that they'll get their questions answered, that they'll find that hope and that grace and that meaning and that purpose? The only way it's going to happen is if witnesses speak up. People who have seen God in action, people who do know truths about Jesus, are brave enough, are courageous enough to speak up. And so I think that's a challenge for all of us to think, are you going to come forward? Not now, like an altar, but come forward and testify into, could be into the court of public opinion, right? It could be that as public discourse and dialogue happens, whether it's on Facebook, whether it's in media, whether it's letters to politicians, wherever it happens. For me, often it was in my uni tutes, right? When those public conversations are happening and no one there is standing up and testifying for Jesus. So everyone who's listening, the jury, are all just going one way. Will you testify? Will you come forward and speak up on Jesus' behalf? And maybe it's not into the court of public opinion. Maybe that's kind of too big a space in some ways. Or maybe that's not a space that your particular testimony is required. But maybe it's to step forward and speak up into just the court of one other person's private opinion. That all they've heard is these particular narratives about Jesus. But that's not your experience of Jesus, but how will they ever know that? Unless you find that opportunity to say, you know what, I don't think that's who Jesus is. This is what He's done in my life. This is what He's taught me. This is what my experience of church has been. Will you stand up and be a witness, court of public opinion, someone else's private opinion, and testify on Jesus' behalf? There's one more truth. I said we're going to get three. We've got that first one, that gospel-shaped outreach happens by God's power, not ours, but He's given us that power, so get on with it, right? That was our first one. The second one, what is outreach? It's not necessarily learning two ways to live or some particular gospel explanation. It's just to be a witness. Just tell people your experience of God. Be open about it. Last one, let's go back to our passage. Where does Jesus say that's going to happen? He says, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Jesus knows how big the earth is, right? He made it. And He's talking to people who He knows do not have Boeing 747s and will not in their lifetime, right? It's clear that Jesus, when He says this, sees this as like a multi-generational, down through the ages, movement of testimony about him, people witnessing about him, such that it covers the entire earth. He said in Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. How can we sum up where it is that Jesus wants us to witness? Like, it's simple, right? Everywhere. Everywhere. Like, on the one hand, we are at the ends of the earth if we were traveling from Jerusalem, right? You can't get much further away geographically. But at the same time, aren't there still places in our lives, in our schools, in our unis, in our workplaces, perhaps in our families, where Jesus has still not been witnessed to? Where, like, I know from teaching scripture in schools where we're in Australia, right? It's a Christian country. But it's hard to find a single student who can actually explain who Jesus is or what Christians believe about him. Or if we were to pull up the average person walking through Rouse Hill Town Centre or Quakers Quarter, wherever we happen to be, and ask them to explain what Christians believe about Jesus, they just don't know. And so there's places, there's ends of the earth that each of us are walking into tomorrow, where Jesus said, someone needs to go there and be a witness and testify about me. I actually think it's fascinating, the whole in Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth, right? Because here's what it seemed like for years when I read it, because I don't really know my kind of biblical historical geography, and so totally fair enough if you don't either. It seemed like what he's saying is like Judea, Samaria, ends of the earth, right? As if we were to say Quakers Hill, Blacktown City Council, the ends of the earth, which kind of seems like a big jump because you've forgotten Sydney, New South Wales, Australia, right? It's kind of a bit weird that he just does these two tiny ones and then explodes out massively. And that's kind of how I understood it. And I'm like, oh, he just couldn't be bothered saying anymore. And he kind of got his scale wrong when he started his list. And then I found out and kind of realized Judea is not in Samaria. I don't know if anyone knows that. Judea is not in Samaria. It's a political boundary now, but if we were to go back to Bible times, it's very clear. They even kind of have the latitude that it's delineated by. These are neighboring areas. This is like Blacktown City Council and the hills, right? Not Blacktown and Sydney. This is neighboring regions. And here's why that's important. Because Judea, that's where Jerusalem is. That's where the Jews were. That's where the disciples are from. That's the place that you would expect people to respond to news about God positively. That's the place that is culturally comfortable and homey for the disciples. And Jesus says, yep, you got to go to that place and be a witness about me. And what's Samaria? Like, the opposite in every way. It's the neighboring region that everyone in Judea hates. That people would travel days around to avoid going through because we can't stand those people. Right? Again, maybe we're back to Blacktown and the hills, right? It's the alongside us, but we don't want to go there, right? We think it would be that they would never respond to God, and I don't even want them to respond to God because I don't want to be connected with them. And now maybe it makes sense when we see Jesus say, go to the close to home, soft, ready to hear the gospel, place that you just feel comfortable, and go to the place that you hate, that is disgusting, that you don't understand those people, that their culture is different, and there's a wall of hostility between you and them. Go to both of those places, to the ends of the earth. Suddenly the comparison makes more sense, right? Because he's drawn it in so that it's included everywhere. The places we love and feel comfortable and happy to go and be a witness there. The places we're anxious, we're fearful of, we're confused by, we're disgusted by, we don't think they'll respond, we think it's just going to be painful, go and be a witness there, such that the end result is the ends of the earth. I was wondering, you guys reflecting on where might the ends of the earth be that you're going to walk tomorrow? I'm probably not, maybe no one else is. Let me finish with just a couple of stats. I heard you guys saying, more stats, so we'll just do a couple more. Oh yeah, seriously, everywhere. This was some research done last year. A group interviewed a couple of thousand people in Australia, and here's something they found, which was actually super encouraging. They found, this was about Christmas services, but the same played out in some other research for just church in general. They found that if you were to ask just your average Aussies if they wanted to come along to church with you, 3 out of 10 would say yes, or probably say yes, and another 15% are unsure, and it would kind of depend a bit on your relationship and what the event was, and those things got teased out by subsequent questions. But what that means is if you were to ask three people to come to church, on average, one of them will say yes, right? Which is super encouraging. And I remember seeing this and going, oh, this is great, because remember, just like those detectives, there are people out there who are investigating and seeking. And they want to find the truth, and they want to find hope, they want to find love, they want to find grace, they want that stuff. And if you were to hold it out to them, if you were to reach out, right, do some outreach, be a witness, they would say yes. That's awesome news. Well, let's look at it with this one as well. 44%, I don't know if you guys can read those words that are up there. It says 44% of Australians know people who currently attend church. It means less than half of people surveyed know that they know someone who goes to church. I'm going to add that extra know in there because I think that's important. Less than half of Australians know that they know someone who goes to church. And over half, 56%, as far as they know, do not currently know anyone who goes to church. It means the ends of the earth where someone needs to witness about Jesus are alive and well. Right? Over half of Australians don't even know if they know a Christian. I actually think those numbers are wrong, and I can't prove this, purely speculative. I fail stats for this, but I think they're wrong, right? I reckon part of what's going on is those 56% of people don't realize that their next-door neighbor goes to church. They don't realize that their colleague goes to church. They don't realize that a classmate in their tute goes to church. They don't realize that their cousin goes to church. I actually think part of what's contributed to this is, as witnesses, and part of why I say that, and I'm not judging you guys, because I know at least one of my neighbors wouldn't know that I go to church and I work for a church, right? I think part of this is we as witnesses have been scared. We haven't been testifying into all of those places. And so I want you to think, where are the places in my life where there are people searching? And if only God had put a witness there to testify. And then think what it might look like for you to walk into that place and be a witness for Jesus. Let's finish up. We've already seen that one. Gospel-shaped outreach. What is it? It's relying on God's power. Don't feel inadequate. Doesn't matter. We're all inadequate. That's the point. He's adequate. Right? So just do it. Gospel-shaped outreach is relying on God's power to do something really simple. You don't have to do a training course to do this. Just tell people what you've seen and heard. Tell them your experience of Jesus. Talk to them about God's stuff. Where should we do it? Everywhere. And as that happens, our prayer is that more and more people in these suburbs around us, in your families, in your communities, will come to know that love and joy and peace and grace and mercy and hope that we have in Jesus. I'm going to pray now that especially as we do this whole Reconnect 2022, as we do this, as we run Alpha, as we do all of those things, that Jesus might see fit to use us to save others. Please pray with me. Jesus, thank you that you told these disciples 2,000 years ago to go to the ends of the earth. As we are here tonight at the ends of the earth, so grateful that generation after generation of your people witnessed. And they didn't just witness things, but they testified. They passed it on. They told stories. They encouraged others to investigate. And as a result of that, we know you. We know love and faith and hope and truth. Jesus, help us to rely not on our own strength, but on you, to trust you. Jesus, help us to share boldly the things we've experienced. Help us to come forward as witnesses and testify about how wonderful you are. Jesus, help us to do that everywhere. And we ask that as a result, many more might come to know the joy and the hope that we have in you. We ask it in your name. Amen.
Please stand with us as we sing our last song.
gosh, gives us lots to think about, which is good because this builds to the rest of the sermon series, but it also opens our eyes to the things that we can do in the community as well. And there's so much out there that we can connect with. And it's actually really exciting that all things, hopefully COVID, are starting to flow away. We can actually get back to outreaching and being people of the gospel. So I'm keen. I'm very, very keen. All right. I'm going to invite Josh back up here again. So he's going to tell us what's happening with pizza. So hopefully, please stick around for pizza. It smells really good. Can you smell it wafting in? It smells really good. So, and you can stay there. Have a seat. All right. He's going to give you a bit of a rundown on how we're going to stack up chairs and stuff. And then I'm going to pray and finish it off. Do you want this?
All right, so here's what's happening. P.S., it's okay. If you're not staying for pizza, that's fine. You can make kind of a discreet exit at some point while we're doing this stuff. But also, pizza, $5, but if you don't have $5, don't leave because of that. Just stay, just eat it. We'll shout your pizza, and we'll be really glad to do it because we're just going to throw it in the bin anyway, right? So make sure you stay if you're keen for some pizza. Here's how it's going to work. Normally, we just stack all the chairs up. This time, we're going to stack some chairs, so 8 high for the light blue, 5 high for the dark blue. But we want to keep out enough to then sit around. And I just put a stack of tables back against that column at the back there, and there's a few there, and some of you guys who are locals will know where they are in the cupboard if we need more. The goal this time, instead of packing chairs, is to pack enough chairs so that we can then just drop some tables out and bring the chairs around those tables, right? That'll be your goal. That's also the time that if you need to discreetly shoot off, you're free to, obviously. But also, even if you don't want pizza, feel free to hang out. Just come and sit at a table, chat for 5 or 10 minutes, leave whenever you like. After we've done all of that stuff, I'll jump back up here and I'll start telling you guys how the making of the pizzas, the cooking of the pizzas, and the eating of the pizzas is all going to play out. But yeah, for packing up chairs, stack of those tables, some other tables here, splotch them all around here, we'll turn some lights on, put the chairs around, we'll get some music up, and then I'll come back after that and tell you how to make the pizzas.
All right, let's finish the service and pray with me. Heavenly Father, thank you for what we've heard tonight. Thank you for your love that you have revealed to us and for the love that we share together as your body. As we leave this place today, thank you that you walk with us. May we be aware of your prompting us and live in your endless love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Enjoy the pizza. Talk to you soon.